what not to discuss. And what we try to demonstrate in the book is that if you simply look at the institutional structure of the media within a state capitalist society like ours, they're performing pretty much the way you'd expect.
Earlier this year, American television viewers were treated to the spectacle on the Sinclair Broadcasting System, which is not that well-known a company, but which owns hundreds of local affiliates in the United States.
The sharing of biased and false
news has become all too common on social media.
They put out an editorial, an editorial where the same words were read by hundreds of different news anchors in small cities from Kansas to the Florida Panhandle. What did you make of all those news anchors in all those markets mouthing those same words and reading those same scripts?
And remember, compelled to do so. They didn't have a choice. You wanted to stay and keep your job, you read what Big Brother told you to read. This is a mode of propaganda that we associate with totalitarian states. The fact that it's done by a private tyranny, which is what a corporation is, doesn't change the character of it. And it's kind of interesting that in actual totalitarian states, say the old Soviet Union, studies showed that people tended to distrust the media because it was so obvious that it was coming from the state authorities.
We don't have to go back far to the days, the halcyon days of social media. The Arab Spring, 2011, so much optimism in the air and a belief that the rise of these alternative voices on these platforms would have a democratizing effect on governance. Turns out that that was misguided. What happened?
Well, first of all, there is a positive aspect to the social media. Almost all activist movements rely on them to bring people together and so on. So what happened in the first months of the Arab Spring was very exciting. You may recall that at one point the dictator Mubarak closed the internet to try to prevent the social media from functioning. What happened is that activism increased, because instead of sending messages out electronically, people actually talked to each other. Now that's the basic, the essential way to organize and create a kind of culture of what I call collective self-defense.
You couldn't have foreseen the emergence of the tech giants, who are such a big part of the global news media today. And their rise has made them unwieldy purveyors of power. They've grown rich at the expense of many media outlets. Has anyone come up with useful ways of how and what to do with them? How to deal with them and what to do with them?
Well, not really. Remember that these are not the sources of news. Like Facebook doesn't have bureaus around the world. What these have created is an array of social media which are double-edged. Sometimes they're used for constructive purposes, but they have also become major forces for undermining democracy. We see that everywhere. Right now in Brazil, for example, a scandal's erupting correctly about the fact that millions of dollars were spent to produce defamatory information on the social media against the PT, the Workers' Party, to support the literally neo-fascist candidate who won the campaign. It's only one example. These things are now happening over and over, and it's a very dangerous phenomenon.
You've written a great deal about Latin America, and a few years back, leaders such as Chavez in Venezuela, Morales in Bolivia, the Kirchners in Argentina, Correa in Ecuador, they were all pushing for some form of media reform, to spread ownership out, to limit the power of conglomerates in Latin America. Their critics then accused them of basically trying to usurp the powers from the political right and drag them off to the left. Did the critics of those leaders who were trying to reform media in Latin America actually have a point?
In fact, the problem of in all of the countries you mentioned is they didn't do anywhere near enough to try to set up alternative, independent, public, publicly controlled media that would counter the high concentration of ultra-right media in Latin America, which has been a scandal for years.
Manufacturing Consent is considered a seminal work. It's not an easy read for people. It's a difficult area to explore and dissect on television in particular because of its limitations and the limited attention spans of some of the people who are watching this program. In conveying some of these ideas, have you ever thought of taking some of those media training courses that those corporate executives take that train them to speak in sound bites?
Oh.
Probably not, huh?
Yeah. I remember once that there was a program called Nightline on television.
ABC.
They got a lot of criticism because I was never on it. And the director said, I'm not the kind of person they could have on because I don't understand concision. Namely, saying two sentences between ads. And that's a terrific form of propaganda. So, for example, if you're asked, is Iran a terrorist state? You can say, yes, they do this and that and the other thing. If you're asked, is the United States a terrorist state, which is, of course, way beyond Iran, you can't say it in 2 minutes, because first you have to break down the prejudices and assumptions and dogmas about the United States being a force for freedom and democracy. You can't do that between two ads. So the very idea of concision is a fine technique for imposing the propaganda of the power of those who are powerful. They can say anything they want against enemies in 2 minutes, but they can't be exposed in 2 minutes.
Final question for you. When you get up in the morning, where do you go to get your news?
First thing I look at is the New York Times.
Still?
It's still, with all of its flaws, and they're real, it still has the broadest and most comprehensive coverage of, I think, any newspaper in the world.
And then where do you go from there?
Then many other places. Washington Post, the business press, foreign press, Al Jazeera, Democracy Now, many other sources.
Noam Chomsky, thank you so much for joining us, The Listening Post.
Thank you.